tonight. So many times we don't do stuff because we're afraid we're going to have to maintain that. Some of us don't smile or act nice because we figure if we act nice one time, people are going to, yep. They're going to expect you to act nice all the time. One of the devil's biggest tools is fear. But we're going to run right past that. This prescription for fear, I told you earlier this over the weekend, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, I believe we have that. 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. Let's see it. Y'all know it already because I've said it about four or five times this week. It says, for God has not given us the spirit of fear. That's the NIV. I'm reading it. Let me read it in the NIV. I like that. For the spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us
power.
It gives us
love
and self-discipline. Y'all, I wish I had time to tell the dunamis story. I'll tell that before the week is over. Because that word power is dunamis power. It's power it's the most powerful word. And that word right there in the Greek language is the most powerful word in the Bible. When Albert Nobel, you know that name, the Nobel Peace Prize?
Yeah.
When he was, y'all know that story? When he was looking for the name of his most famous invention that you probably didn't know he invented, that invention was dynamite.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
The man that the Peace Prize is named after invented dynamite. And when he asked his theologian friend for the most powerful word in the Bible, his friend came back a few weeks later and said, the most powerful word in the Bible is dunamis power. God is saying, I'm giving you power that will break down strongholds.
Come on, preacher.
I'm giving you power that will allow you to stand though the heavens may fall.
Amen.
That's the kind of power God wants to give you. So fear, you need to sidestep fear and doubt. The second weapon that the devil uses. I wish I had time tonight, but I got to keep going. The second weapon that the devil uses is failure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna let that marinate for a minute. I wonder if that window's open. You think we can open that window a little bit more?
Yeah.
The second weapon the devil uses is failure.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm actually gonna ask for a show of hands tonight. Raise your hand if you've ever failed at something. Be honest, Pastor. I've tried many things and I've failed. I consider myself to be a serial entrepreneur.
No.
I'll say it the way I want to say it.
Entrepreneur.
Serial entrepreneur-negro. I've tried many a business, and brothers and sisters, sometimes it failed because I was being lazy, and other times it simply failed because it just wasn't time yet, or for whatever reason it was, I failed. But one thing I know for sure is nothing beats a failure like a try.
Come on, preacher.
And you know, some of these sayings, you don't understand them until you get a little older, because you keep hearing them. I used to hear another saying that said, call me anything, but don't call me late for dinner. I was like, what in the world does that mean? In other words, when you live in a large family and you get called late for dinner, what does that mean?
You
missing out. So they say, call me anything. You can call me out my name. Just don't call me late for dinner. And so that saying, nothing beats a failure like a try, means that every time you fail, you need to try again. But the devil uses that because many of us, when we failed, we didn't try again. We had a relationship and it failed, and we curled up in our little corner and we decided, I'm afraid of the world. I failed at that relationship. I'm not going to try it again. But that's not the way it ought to be, brothers and sisters. Einstein didn't speak until he was 4, and he didn't read until he was 7, but he never gave up. Thomas Edison's teachers told him he was too stupid to learn. He was fired from his first 2 jobs as an inventor, and he made 1,000 failed attempts. I told you last week, 1,000 failed attempts at inventing the light bulb. But brothers and sisters, on that 1,001 attempt, that light bulb lit up, and you and I can come here tonight, and we don't need no kerosene lamps. We don't need a tilling lamp. We can hit a switch, and the electricity comes. Oh, y'all.
Yes,
yeah, 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 yeah. solid, man. Solid.
The devil wants us to look at failure.
Yes.
And I remember the story, Pat LaCoupe. I told this story at your church. I remember at Ilford Lane. Amen. And I, this story was of a donkey. Y'all know I love stories. I don't know if I'm going to get to the fourth weapon. We're going to have to split this up two and two. But the donkey, an old donkey on this farm, he was just, it's farm night tonight. Yeah, that's what you said. It's farm night tonight. Yeah. And I ain't going to ask you what a donkey sound like, because somebody's going to mock you later on. They're going to say, yeah, you sure do know how to sound like a donkey. But that donkey, in the night, he fell into a well. It was an old well. It was a dried up well. And so in that well, the donkey just began to wail and cry and scream and kick and make all this noise. And all the farmers around, they were sick of it. So they came to help that farmer go ahead and just bury the donkey alive in the well. Mm-hmm. And so they started shoveling dirt down into the well. They said, we got to put this donkey out of his misery. And that donkey was just wailing and crying and wailing and moaning. And finally, all of a sudden, the wailing and the moaning stopped.
Yeah.
And so they said, oh man, how much more we got to shovel? And they looked down in the hole and they saw something they couldn't believe. Kind of, I don't want to shake my hips too hard. I don't want to say the pastor dancing in church. That donkey would just shake that dirt all over the back. And he would stomp it down and he would step on up.
All right.
And so he started shoveling it faster. He'd shake it off. And finally, eventually, that donkey took a step and stepped right on out of that well. Don't let the devil catch you with failure, brothers and sisters. It is a falsehood. Oh, let me give you the prescriptions. I think y'all ready for the prescription. Y'all ready for the prescription? The prescription for failure is found in Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Let's put it in. Yeah, here we go. I like this NIV thing y'all doing tonight. It says, I can do all things. But they don't say things. It's the NIV, y'all. Now, y'all so prompt. Y'all get lashes. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. And I want you to know that strength that he's given you is that dunamis power. You can shake off whatever the devil wants to throw your way, brothers and sisters. Oh, the third weapon. Oh, the third weapon. So the first weapon is what? Fear. The second weapon that he uses is failure. And the third weapon is, y'all ain't ready for this one.
Yeah.
Flattery.
Uh-huh.
Can I talk about it?
Yeah.
And the problem is, whether it's true or not, some people only flatter you so they can gain favor with you. Ladies, can I talk to the ladies tonight? You see, God made men. Y'all say, oh, Pastor, always talking to the ladies. Men, I'll help you out. Give me a man. You see, ladies, God made men with these deep voices for a reason. I mean, I don't know about the brothers with the high voices. Brothers with deep voices, see, if ladies, you've got to be careful. You've got to be careful because that man will come to the, hey, girl. God, you look so good.
Why?
And then, you know, he'll let that key out of it. All of a sudden, you stand there and you start feeling nervous and you want to fan yourself. You're having a personal summer and you're trying to figure out what's going on. You better watch out.
No, she's
what's going on?
After that.
Hey, our preacher.
I'm getting hot just listening to my own voice. Y'all bad. The devil will marry you.
Yes.
Make it be comfortable.
I wish you'd hear me tonight. The devil will tell you some things that sound so true. You ever seen somebody wearing something they ain't got no business wearing?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I ain't just saying because they big. Hello? Uh-huh. There's some folk that little that wear some stuff they ain't got no business wearing either. Hello? And man and woman.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
But it's because somebody, and I hope it wasn't themselves. Let everybody else lie to you, but don't lie to yourself.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Girl,
but somebody said,
girl, you look good in that thing right there. And you believe it.
Yeah.
And you buy into it.
And many times we'll go to the dealership, man, come on, man, hello. And we'll buy that car that we can't afford. Uh-huh. In order that we can attract, because you know, men, we're like peacocks.
Yes.
Just look at nature. You can learn a whole lot about mankind from nature, from the flowers, from the plants. Henry Ford learned how to build his Ford motor plants from George Washington Carver.
That's right.
Who studied plants and realized how plants fertilize and create more plants. And so he showed Henry Ford how to build automobiles on an assembly line the same way plants, flowers, make other flowers. Mm-hmm. So look at nature and you'll see something. Men, we like to be like peacocks. And so even when we can't afford it, even when it doesn't even fit our character, it's out of our personality. We will do things to show off so that and when the folks will flatter you and they'll empty your pockets at the same time.
Ain't no gold diggers in the house tonight.
I want to talk to the young people. I hope the older folk are listening. Young people, there's something called the 12 stages of intimacy. Mm-hmm. I'll give you some of that hidden knowledge. Because see, my parents didn't talk to me about intimacy. If I gave my parents a grade, and I love them, I hope y'all not watching tonight. If I gave my parents a grade, I'd give them about a B+. And that's pretty good, right? They didn't fail. But I'd have gave them an A+ if they would have just talked to me about intimacy.
Yes.
That's like one of the main things, intimacy and money.
Mm-hmm.
I know I'm not the only one here tonight whose parents did not talk to them about sex and money. Uh-huh. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I know the culture that we come out of, hello? They don't talk of, the first thing my daddy said to me about sex was, are you gay? And the first thing my mother said to me about sex, I really can't repeat here tonight. But basically, it really had nothing to do with it. Because they gave me what they had.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But the devil is able to steal a march, and when we get flattered, we just give ourselves, we just do the things that are foolish. Why? Because we don't understand the 12 stages of intimacy. There's 12 stages. The first stage, brothers and sisters, if I get it right, you can Google it and check the pastor out, make sure he tell you the truth. But I believe the first stage is when you see one another.
Mm.
And you say, whoa.
Yes.
Look at that there. You know, when Adam saw Eve, hello, he went from being a zoologist to a poet. He went from naming monkeys and elephants and ants and roaches and whatever else was on the world, whatever other animals, fish of the sea and bird of the air, he was naming them. And when he saw Eve, he just spun around and said, whoa! He said, flesh of my flesh and bone of my bone. Brothers and sisters, it's eye to eye. And then you go down the stages where at some point you end up beside each other and you hold hands. And then from there, at some point, you will lay hand on the shoulder and you may kiss on the cheek and you may grab one another around the waist. And by time you get to 9, 10, 11, 12, y'all know what happened in them stages. All right, I ain't gonna. The children are listening. That's where babies are made. Did I keep it PG tonight?
Yes.
But in this day and age, people are meeting in one night. And with a few well-positioned, well-placed, well-sounding words of flattery, people are going from laying eyes on each other to laying with each other in the bed. Flattery will destroy you, brothers and sisters.
It'll destroy you in leadership, brothers and sisters. You get high and mighty. People come and say, you're doing such a great job. Oh, look at you. But see, watch out when people come with flattery. Hello? Because more than likely they have some other agenda and you just wait. Oh, Lord, I know I'm telling you the truth tonight. Amen, Walls. I'm going to give you the prescription that I want to get to the last one tonight. Prescription for flattery is very simple. It's Philippians chapter 5, verse 11. It's very simple. It says, I like this NIV. I'm going to start reading NIV. It says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Jesus didn't flatter nobody. He told the truth. He told the truth in season and out of season, because the truth cuts like a two-edged sword. And I made up this statement many years ago. I said, the truth hurts, but the truth helps. Sometimes, when somebody tells you the truth about yourself, sometimes it's going to feel nice. You're looking good. And sometimes you need to tell yourself the truth. Oh, I wish I had time. You see, before this campaign, I never would watch my messages. Didn't want to hear myself. Didn't want to see myself, because I have an image of myself that when I look at myself, I say, oh, Lord, I hope they get my slim angles. You know what I'm saying? But then, you know, I've been watching. Y'all don't think I'm being high and mighty when I said, but I've been watching the messages, and it ain't so much what I was saying, but I said, boy, you look good.
Amen, Pastor.
You look dangerously good. Sometimes you gotta talk to yourself like that. Hello?
Yeah, of course.
But beware when other people come, because many times they have an agenda, but you'll know when they're telling the truth and when they're trying to fill your head. I'm gonna leave that right there. I think the Spirit will minister to you on that. But remember the prescription: let this mind be in you that is also in Christ Jesus. And if the mind of God is in you, you will not be tripped up by the enemy, because this is what I need you to do. When you let the mind of Jesus be in you, that means you're reading the Word of God. That means you're hearing the Holy Spirit. Hello? And that means you're exchanging thoughts with God. Some of you need to stop talking to your friends who ain't been no further in life than you, hello, and rejecting the advice of the seniors and the elderly and those who've been further down the road than you. And who has been further down the road than you than God himself?
Amen.
Exchange thoughts with God, because his thoughts are higher.
Yes.
I think you got that. Yes. Let me go to this last one. I'm ready for this last one. Don't put it up yet. Down, but don't put it up yet. The last. Now, you notice they all start with F, right? Mm-hmm. Fair.
Yes.
Failure.
Flattery. Can someone guess the fourth one? And not the fellas in the back, because I already gave it to them. Huh?
Friends?
Yeah, friends can lead you down the wrong path. Anybody else?
Family.
Family can jack you up too.
Funds.
Faults. Yeah, we all have faults. Y'all ain't ready for this one. This, I'm gonna give it to you. This is the most insidious. Are you listening? This is the most insidious of all of the weapons that the devil will use on us in these last days. And it's a four-letter word called food.
Whoa! I should have known. It's true.
Somebody said, "Ah!"
Yes,
Ellen White said,
true.
She said, "In the last days." And when I used to hear this, I used to be like, "That is foolishness."
No.
I used to be like, "No way! You can't tell me that in the last days the devil is going to get me on appetite."
Yes.
What?
Mm-hmm.
That don't make no sense.
Mm-hmm.
But the world that we live in today, what scientists are able, y'all don't hear me tonight.
Mm-hmm.
What scientists are able to do with food, you cannot even imagine. How many of you have ever heard of a GMO, a genetically modified organism? Here in the UK, you've heard of that. Because your government at least makes it mandatory that if a food is GMO, it has to be listed as GMO, right?
Yeah.
In the United States, it's so sinister. If it's GMO, it doesn't have to be listed. Don't even have to put it on there. So praise your government for that. I can appreciate the UK for that. But still, brothers and sisters, the reality is there are other foods that we don't even understand how they're made, what they're doing now. There was this lady that was eating a hamburger from Burger King, and all of a sudden she broke out and she went into anaphylactic shock, and she needed an EpiPen. Why? Because she's allergic to shellfish, but she was eating a hamburger with lettuce and tomatoes. But later on, when they did their research, praise the Lord, she didn't die, but they found out that the tomato that was in the hamburger had been spliced with a shellfish, the DNA of a shellfish, so that it could last long, have a longer shelf life. Y'all don't hear me tonight. We're talking about genetically modifying food. Y'all know some other
the horse meat.
I don't even want to talk about the horse meat scandal. Brothers and sisters, the corn is in everything. Some of us are coming up with allergies these days. Been living all our lives eating certain foods, and as we're getting older, the doctor says, "Oh, it's just a matter of age. You're just getting older. And you're not as tolerant." But what it is that they're putting things in the corn. That there's something called Roundup. You ever heard of Roundup? It's a pesticide. It's a weed and pest killer. They have taken it and put the Roundup into the corn. They have biologically implanted into the DNA of the corn. And when the pest eat on the corn while it's growing, the pest dies. And then they turn it into ketchup, and they turn it into crisps. Is that what we call it here? To chips called crisps.
Yeah.
And they turn it into all of these. You if you go online and you look up all the things that have corn in it. And now, so wait a minute. If the pest eat the corn and he dies because the Roundup is inside of the corn, what's happening to you and me when we eat the Roundup? Guess what? They don't even know what's happening to us.
They don't care.
And somebody said, like, "Pastor, you're putting too much on that food thing. You're putting too much on that food thing." But I want to close. And I'm going to go to Jesus right before I close. But let me share this with you, brothers and sisters. You see what happened with Jesus. Or not what happened with Jesus, but what happened with the food is that it's the same trick that he played on our original mother and father.
Yes.
He brought them to a tree to eat of a fruit. And whether some of y'all believe it was a literal fruit or a figurative fruit, I believe it was a real fruit if you ask me. Hello?
Yeah.
Because it says Eve, she ate of the fruit and she gave it to her husband to eat. I accept the word of God. Amen?
Yes.
And that fruit did something to the human body. And if you ask me, I believe that it went down into the DNA, to the mitochondrial DNA, down to a cellular level in the human body. And I believe in that light that was emanating through man, from eating from the tree of life. And I know some folk believe the tree of life wasn't real. Some folks say that they didn't get to eat from the tree of life yet. But brothers and sisters, that my Bible is pretty plain to me. I believe they were already eating from the tree of life, and their bodies were lit up with the glory of God, and God walked with them in the cool of the evening.
Yes.
And remember, I taught you that when Moses was with God as a fallen human being, his face would shine with the glory of God. So could you imagine Adam and Eve, unfallen beings walking with God? Their bodies were emanating with light all the way down to the cellular level. Their bodies were emanating with light. But when they ate of the fruit, because the tree was the knowledge of both good and evil. When God created everything, stay with me now, put on your thinking caps. Come on, let me teach again for a few moments, and then I'm going to preach this on out of here. Is that all right?
Yeah.
When they went to the tree, it was the tree of good and evil. Now, when God created man, he looked at everything he made, and he said, "It is good," right? And so mankind knew what good was, but what it treated that tree wasn't good fruit. It was a fruit that represented evil. And when she ate of that fruit, it went down to her and to Adam at a cellular level, and I believe it went to their cells that were bright with the light of the living God, and those cells were living, ready to live for eternity, and that evil fruit turned off that